Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Courtside with Beilinson Tennis, part of the Tennis Channel Podcast Network. We have with us today a Texas A&M lifer. This guest played his collegiate tennis for the Aggies in the early 90s. He later served 6 years as a volunteer coach for the A&M for the A&M's women's team before being hired as the women's assistant coach in 2007, and then eventually becoming the head coach for the women's team on July 30th, 2015. Please welcome to the pod, Texas A&M women's head tennis coach, Mark Weaver. Coach, thank you for taking time and speaking with me today.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. Thank you very much for having me.
So, I mean, obviously, I got to start with the question I've been asking every one of my guests right now. It's truly a unique time dealing with COVID-19. How are you holding up?
Yeah, holding up just fine. Definitely some unusual times for myself and everyone. And just trying to make the best of the situation here. Certain days are busier than others. Some days I have quite a few Zoom meetings and other types of phone calls. And then other days, what normal am I doing today?
So, right.
But we.
Do you have any of your players on campus yet or no?
We have a couple of players that have been around town for the most part. They haven't been allowed to use our facilities just yet, not our tennis courts at least. They just started letting the players, the athletes, start using the fitness. So we started that on June 8th. So they've been working out a little bit here, but we're not actually allowed to be with them just yet. So.
Right. Well, slowly but surely, hopefully things will start getting back to whatever this new normal is going to be. So I know we're going to get to present day of what you're doing now with your team and all that you've been doing at Texas A&M, but I'm curious to know your beginnings and how you started in the sport. And obviously you did some great work because you were being recruited by real good schools. So why don't you tell us a little bit about your journey once it all started?
Yeah, I got started when I was about 5 years old. I grew up in Shreveport, Louisiana. I was born and raised there, went all the way through high school in Shreveport. So I got started by my father. My dad, he really didn't take up tennis until his early 30s or so. And, tennis was very popular back then with, guys like Borg and Connors and McEnroe. And it was very popular in Shreveport during those years of growing up. And my dad started me. We would walk down or drive to the local junior high school, Broadmoor Junior High School. We used to practice on the gray concrete tennis courts. It looked kind of like parking lots with the chain link nets. And we would go almost every day for about an hour or so. And I played my first tournament when I was 8 years old in Natchitoches, Louisiana. I actually won my first tournament I ever played on my grandfather's birthday.
So nice.
So I grew up in Shreveport and I played in the Southern Section. The Southern Section was very, very tough competition back then. There were guys, Chris Woodruff, a very familiar name in tennis. He was just a tad bit younger than me, but we grew up playing each other all through the juniors. We had some very, very strong players in the Southern Section there. So.
Well, I mean, obviously you had a heck of a junior career, right? I mean, you're not going to get recruited by the schools you were getting recruited to without having some success. What were some of the highlights that you really were proud of growing up?
Well, I was fortunate enough. Louisiana wasn't necessarily the strongest state in the nation. So I was always the top ranked player in Louisiana, at least in my older division. Whenever I would be that, we'd call the second year of your
right.
division, I was always the top player in the state. So, that was something that probably helped my confidence a lot, even though maybe the competition wasn't that strong. It made me kind of feel good about myself and maybe thought I was even a little better than I was. And I did fairly well on the Southern circuit, and then in the national tournaments I did well, but not that great until I hit kind of a nice growth spurt around maybe 15, 16 years old. I started working a bit in the gym and kind of grew into my feet. I always kind of had big feet, size 14 shoe I wear, and I know my parents got me into soccer for a few years. It kind of helped me with my coordination and my footwork. And, I can still remember my dad and I just hitting at the junior high school courts. You put up four ball cans on the court and put a dollar bill underneath it. And then anytime I hit it with my serve, I got a dollar bill. So my serve became kind of my strength and my weapon. And that really kind of opened up a lot of doors for me. And I did pretty well during the most important years of when you're getting recruited by universities, and developed my serve and ultimately really helped me be a successful college tennis player.
So what were, and obviously money is always a great incentive. So good move by your dad right there. what were some of the schools that you were most interested in and they were maybe interested in you? And ultimately, why did A&M win out?
Yeah, my visits were, I started out at Rice University as my first visit. I kind of have a somewhat funny story. I'll go back to that story in a second. But Rice University and Wake Forest were a couple of my first visits. And I went to Ole Miss and LSU. And you know, growing up in Louisiana, if you're an athlete, you're kind of supposed to go to LSU. But I really felt like A&M was the right fit for me. And I left Coach Kent. I played for David Kent. And he was a great man. And I just felt very comfortable with him. And yeah, going back to the Rice University story, I was at, on campus there at in Houston, and they took me to the football game. And of course, they actually played the Super Bowl at the Rice University way back when. I forget what exact year it was. So it's kind of a neat stadium. But, you know, as a lot of people know, Rice is a very, very good academic school. It's a small school. I think, you know, they only have around 3,000 students, but there's probably only about 3,000 Rice students and about 50,000 Aggies, you know, at Rice University in Houston. And, oh, by the way, the Aggies won, I think, 60-10 or so. But I actually hadn't been talking to Texas A&M a whole lot, but it was just kind of funny how that actually did work out. And I have a really funny recruiting story to Texas A&M. You know, back then, we obviously didn't have cell phones or all the internet and all the social media. So we really didn't get a lot of phone calls. And I can remember my girlfriend from high school was going to go visit Texas A&M, and the school will leave unnamed in Austin, University of Texas. We actually went to visit there. And so we showed up on campus at Texas A&M, and we were watching the men's tennis team practice and just sitting up in the stands. And Coach Kent was down there. We hadn't met yet. He didn't know what I looked like or anything. So he just starts talking to us from down below, looking up at us in the stadium. And he says, "Oh, where are you guys from?" And from Shreveport, Louisiana. He says, "Oh, there's this really good tennis player from Shreveport, Louisiana." And I said, "Oh, really? Who's that?" And he said, "Mark Weaver." And I said, "I'm Mark Weaver." So that's so he kind of ran up in the stands, and that's kind of how it all got started. And then I eventually went back on an official visit with my family and just fell in love with the campus and Coach Kent. So it's kind of funny how it all worked out.
That is too funny. Yeah. Thanks for sharing that. It's amazing how things like that happen. You obviously had tremendous success when you were playing at A&M. You led them to the Southwest Conference at the time, right? You led them to their first Southwest Conference championship, also won the 1994 Southwest Conference number one doubles title. And I believe you still have the record with a 0.805 career winning percentage in doubles at the team. Does that still hold up?
I think it still holds up. There's definitely been some better players that have played there since me. Austin Krycek played at A&M, and he was NCAA doubles champion, and he's around top 40 in the world in doubles right now. And Jackson Withrow is doing quite well as well. They play all the Grand Slams, but I do believe that the percentage record still holds up. And yeah, I was very fortunate that I was able to leave with helping the team win our first Southwest Conference title, and that was a pretty strong conference back then. We still had Texas and TCU were powerhouses, and really every team in there was quite strong. Even Arkansas was in there. And yeah, I was fortunate enough, actually won the Southwest Conference singles my junior year, and then won it the doubles my senior year, and actually didn't have quite as well of an individual year my senior year as I did my junior year. But when we won the team, it was so much more rewarding than when I had won it in the the singles or even the doubles. And we were upset TCU in the finals. They were ranked, I believe, 3 in the nation, so it wasn't really a win. We were expecting to win, and that was quite a rewarding feeling, and to win it for Coach Kent, and it was a great feeling. Winning the team title was so much more rewarding than any of the individual titles, and that's just one of the things I oftentimes, not necessarily that story, but just tell recruits. It's one of the few times, you know, tennis is such an individual sport, and one of the few times you're going to get to play for a team unless you're fortunate enough to play Fed Cup or Davis Cup. The team experience is just such a fun time.
Well, you summed up college experience, the college tennis experience to a T there. Like, you could accomplish all these individual accolades, and yes, it is amazing. But like you summed up, when you do something as a team, it's so much more cooler and so much more fun. You get to celebrate together. So you obviously loved it so much. You really didn't leave, but there was a short time where you did leave. You tried to play the professional tour for a little bit. You had success. I think you won like 10 doubles titles in the Futures and Challenger circuits, right?
I did fairly well my first year. I actually I spent an extra year. It took me 5 years to actually graduate. I never went to summer school, so I was always playing tournaments in the summer and some pro tournaments in the summer, and I actually spent my whole fifth year of school teaching a country club just to save up some money. It's such a expensive sport to travel on when you're trying to make it on the pro circuit. So actually, I was still practicing with the team, so I'm trying to keep my game sharp. And I did graduate in May of 95. And kind of won my first doubles tournament right off the bat. And I had some pretty good success in the doubles. I kept trying to want to make it in the singles. Doubles at the time, just there was hardly any money involved and very little notoriety. So I kept trying to still make it in the singles. In hindsight, I probably should have focused on the doubles more. I think my doubles game was getting better and better. My singles game was probably getting a little weaker and weaker as time was passing. But it was definitely some enjoyable days. I was kind of one of those things, I had to do it to get it out of my system, and glad I did it and have no regrets. And
yeah,
that's something that, you know, kids these days, I think you've got that itch in you got to go out and do it, and just so you don't ever look back and say, oh, I wish I had given it a good shot yet.
Absolutely. I mean, my saying, right, you only live once, right? If you have a chance to do something that you think you want to do, go do it, especially at that young age. I mean, it's not like you're, you know, settled down with the whole family yet. You got a mortgage and all these things. If you have a unique opportunity to do something very, very few people have the chance to do, why not go out and try it? So kudos to you for doing that. And again, you had some success, but at the end of the day, something about Texas A&M lured you back in. You started out as a volunteer assistant for a while. You then were the assistant, and now you're the head coach. What was that like? Who lured you back in? Obviously you had that love of the school, but who were your mentors, or was this something that you thought you wanted to do maybe when you were ending playing professionally?
Well, I can still have a vivid memory of when I was on the tennis team. I believe it was my junior year. I think it's maybe my fall of my senior year, of just being out on the practice courts there and just thinking, I wanted to be a college coach one day, and definitely wanted to be the coach at Texas A&M one day. So I did have that in me. I think a lot of that was influenced by Coach Kent. Unfortunately, Coach Kent passed away a few years back. We were a great relationship when I was on the team, and when I did move back, we became even better friends then. But I can think back to my playing days of wanting to be a college coach, and so I kind of always had it in my blood, and I lost maybe track of that a little bit when I went off the play. And I was just very fortunate when I knew my time was done on the pro circuit. I trying to figure out my life and what course I wanted to take exactly. And so I actually did have a great job offer, Briarcrest Country Club in Bryan, Texas, which is the connecting city to College Station. They offered me director of tennis job there, and it was really a great job. It had a nice salary, and they gave me just a whopper of a deal that really couldn't pass up. And I had a good relationship with the women's tennis coach at the time, Bobby Kleinicke. Coach Kleinicke was the head coach for 26 years, and he was the coach when I was on the team. And he and my coach, David Kent, were great friends. And so I knew that going back, I could kind of get my foot in the door. And I was fortunate enough to be his volunteer coach for 6-7 years or so. And I wasn't out there all the time. I did a lot of the home matches, the coaching. I was making my living teaching at the country club, but I was around the team for quite a long time. And I had always told Coach Kleinicke, hey, if the job ever opens, I'd love to be your assistant coach. And time just kind of kept going by. It never really happened. He had some assistants he was happy with. And then it just kind of all just fell into place. Majory Terberg was the assistant coach, and she had a baby there that summer and was still planning on coming back. But then kind of late September hit, the season had already started. And then she told Coach Kleinicke, hey, I just want to focus on being a mom for now. And it was just great. I was there right down the street, and it was kind of an easy hire, I guess, with the timing of it all. I was available and ready to get going. So I eventually quit working at the tennis club, and I just kind of made the smooth transition in to Texas A&M. And I was Coach Kleinicke's assistant coach for 4 years, and I learned a whole lot from him. He's a great man and really, really good with the team harmony, team chemistry aspect of it. I felt like I learned a lot from him. And we had some good years there. Unfortunately, he was let go there, and they hired Howard Joffe. And Howard came in, and I was still on kind of helping him with the transition. And the administration said, well, Howard, you know, the assistant coach hired, that's up to you. Obviously, Mark's here, and we'd like for you to look at him. And at the end of the day, Howard and I just kind of hung out a few days, and I helped him with a few things. And he just, Mark, it's a no-brainer. I want you to stay on. Howard and I were pretty similar in ages. He's a year older than me, and we had similar playing backgrounds. We didn't really know each other that well. We knew each other's names, so we did kind of have to get to know each other a while. I was very fortunate to stay on. And Howard did such a great job. Boom, our second year on with Howard there, we made the NCAA finals. And we actually, in my opinion, should have won that match. We lost to Stanford 4-3 in the finals. We should have won the doubles point, and then we at number one singles, we were up 6-0, 3-0 against Nicole Gibbs at number one and lost that one. And then it came down to number two singles, where we were up 2-0 in the third set at 2 against Christiane. And then didn't quite get it. We lost it 4-3. And we had some great years. Howard stayed on for 2 more years after that. We had 2 more top 10 finishes. I think with our success there, the administration decided to keep me on. I know the girls really fought for me, too. They really wanted me as the head coach. So it just kind of all just took its course. Hard to believe I just finished up my 5th season as the head coach now, my 13th paid season. And I guess it's over 20 years now of actually helping coach the women's tennis team. So hard to believe time's flying.
Unbelievable. And, I mean, like, you kind of had the ideal situation. Not many people could probably be a volunteer assistant, which is unpaid, for that long, but you had a nice job at the country club that allowed you to do that. That was a perfect setup for you to really sink your teeth into the college game as far as coaching. And I mean, no one will ever say, no one has more love for the university than you do right now. I mean, this is where you played. This is where you coached at every level, from volunteer to assistant to head coach. You've had a lot of success, and 2017 was a big year for your squad. I know you had big wins. You beat Georgia. I think you beat Duke and Baylor as well, right? You reached the Sweet 16 that year in the NCAA tournament.
That, That's correct. Yes, that was my second year on as the head coach there. We beat number two Georgia at Georgia. That was the last match of the conference season. I remember Georgia was playing for the conference title, and we kind of ruined their day a little bit. But yeah, that was a big win for us. They were number two in the nation, and it came down to number two singles, and Rutuja Bhosale from India clinched it for us in three sets. She's now on the Fed Cup team with India, and yeah, she's ranked 100 or so in doubles right now, and she actually just got engaged there. And yeah, we had a good win over Duke as well. They're obviously a powerhouse every year. We beat them at the national indoors, and then you know, we upset one of our rivals, Baylor, at Baylor on the road to make the Sweet 16. So that was a really good year for us there, and we had a very, very strong schedule that year. Had a very, very good team and a very, very difficult schedule. I remember we were never dropped out of the top 20 all year in the rankings, but we were actually in jeopardy of making the NCAA tournament that year. We were 10-10 going in the last few weeks against we had still five top 20 teams to play on the road, and yeah. We actually got four of those. It was just a really a lot of close matches played. We for sure had the toughest schedule in the nation that year, I think.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I mean, your record may not look, you know, eye-opening. Oh, my God, they're so dominant. But you're battle-tested, and whoever you're going to face when you're playing for the highest of stakes, you're going to be battle-tested, and you're not going to be scared to go out and compete. So you got that. You just got to get in.
Exactly, exactly. And, yeah, we were able to upset Baylor that year and make the Sweet 16. And then that was definitely a big highlight. And then the last season that we finished, obviously not this season that got canceled, but yeah, the season before, that was a really kind of a breakthrough year in the sense of it was a whole new team there. We had a very, very young team. We actually had the youngest team in the nation. We had all freshmen and sophomore. It was part of the number one recruiting class in the nation for the fall, and it ended up being the number two class for the spring. But yeah, we were able to upset Texas at Texas again. We upset our big rival on the road once again in Texas to make the Sweet 16. And they had a great team that year and were definitely capable of probably going the whole way. So, and then obviously anyone knows that Texas A&M knows about the big rivalry with Texas, so be able to do that there. And it was for sure awkward playing against my good buddy Howard Joffe, and you know, that was definitely a good day for the Aggies there.
Yeah, I mean, it's amazing. You look at in all sports, there's some coaches that have played there, been an assistant, and been and now the head coach. It's rare. It's really special. I mean, your situation, played, volunteer, assistant, head coach. I don't know how many of those are replicated, but again, when you're recruiting someone and they talk about and they ask you about the school, I mean, no one's going to love the school any more than you do. And I know this year is just bizarre for everybody involved. And I know you were looking forward to get rocking and rolling with your team, continue the successes that your program has had. And, I just, you know, I don't want to take up too much more of your time. I know we're hoping for a smooth 2020-2021 academic and athletic year. Hopefully there's not many hopefully there's not too many starts and stops, because no one really wants that. And I wish you health, your team health, and everybody in the university healthy, because it's going to be some interesting times going forward here, Coach.
Definitely be some interesting times. It'll be interesting to see how, you know, the decisions are made going forward, because obviously players, the student athletes, and I'm sure even the coaches are, you know, they're going to get the virus, unfortunately. So it'll be interesting to see how the decisions are made going forward. But yeah, we sure hope that we can get things back to normal or as close to it as we can. I know we all miss sports, and we're ready to get back in action.
For sure. Coach, thanks for doing this. This was a fun conversation for me. Again, my favorite part of doing this is hearing everybody's journeys, and everybody's journeys are different. And I get such a kick out of talking with everybody and hearing their stories. And thanks. This was fun.
No, thanks so much for having me. This is a blast.
No problem. Good luck, Coach.
Thanks a lot. Take care.
Bye.